on my way home from work, I got a phone call from my lawyer, and she told me to get off the train at the next station and call her back. And I was like, oh, okay. So I got off the train at the very next stop. I was standing on the platform and wasn't sure what I was going to hear. I had no idea. And I called her and she said, we've just received a fax from your husband's lawyer saying that he and the children have moved out. And I wanted to let you know before you got home. And I was just stunned. I was shocked. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And what do you mean? And she said, well, he and the children have gone. I really wondered how my husband, this man who had laid next to me with his head on the pillow next to mine for 25 years, could be capable of doing such a thing. It just didn't seem to make sense. I haven't spoken to them since the day before they were abducted.
Japan is a complex mix of old and new, an ultra-modern society with traditional values, functional yet constrained, and at times conflicting. I've come to Japan to investigate a controversial custody law that's cutting off some Australian parents from their kids.
Under Japanese laws, only one parent maintains custody following a divorce. That means one parent makes all the decisions about the child's life. Now, they can choose to let the other parent be involved, or they can deny access and cut them out. And that's exactly what happened to an Australian mum I'm about to meet.
Hi, Catherine. Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Can you just take your shoes off here, please?
So, Catherine, yes. Tell me about this room and what do you have in here?
Yeah, so this is the spare bedroom, and these are some of the few things that I have left of the children's. These are some little Japanese outfits that my daughter had worn to festivals and things like that.
How old would she have been when she wore this?
Under one. Oh. Yeah, so it's a little jacket here. And in this box are all knitted clothes that my mother had knitted.
Wow.
When my daughter was born.
How yes. do you feel going through all these belongings?
I actually haven't looked at these for a very long time. I didn't remember that my mum had made so many, actually. Yeah, like these are the first clothes that they ever wore. So yeah, I've kept. Oh, and the first little
boots. Oh, cute.
Somebody sent. Yes, yeah, so these are very. Yeah, I just had to keep, I can't get rid of them because this is all I have left.
In 2019, without warning, Catherine's husband moved out, taking their two kids. At the time, she had no idea how final this separation would be.
I went home and opened the front door with some trepidation and went inside, and the children's bedroom was completely blank. There was no furniture. There was just some carpets on the floor and one shelf. I couldn't believe that he would do something that is so obviously harmful to the children. I don't doubt that he loves them, but I believe that this is a really harmful act.
High school teacher Catherine met the man she thought she'd spend the rest of her life with in Australia in 1996. They married and decided to start a new life together in his native Japan. They had two kids, a girl and a boy. But after 15 years of family life, the marriage came to an end.
So in 2017, on our 15-year wedding anniversary, I booked a restaurant, a Spanish restaurant, for us to go out for dinner. And partway through the meal, he asked me for a divorce, and I was completely and utterly shocked. I had absolutely no idea that he was going to ask me for a divorce on that day.
Catherine's husband filed for divorce in 2018. It was while they were negotiating custody that Catherine's husband took the children.
I feel like I should have been given an opportunity to at least be able to talk to them. I mean, I have a lot of feelings, and mostly, again, it's just complete and utter disbelief. Like, I would just catch the train home from work so many days, and you'd just be sitting there normally, and then all of a sudden you'd remember and you'd go, my kids have been abducted and I haven't seen them. And like, even now I can't believe it's been 3.5 years. And I don't understand how a country can prevent me from seeing my children when I haven't done anything wrong. Does a country have that right? I don't know, but it feels wrong.
In Japan, parental abduction of a child is, in some cases, considered legal. In nearly all custody disputes, Japanese family courts grant sole custody to whoever has physical control of the children at the time of divorce.
They absolutely give all of the benefits to the parents that abduct their children. So it's almost like you're the fool for not having abducted. It's basically a race to abduct. But the problem in my case was I didn't know about that, and I don't think I could have. But it's basically whoever abducts first wins. That's the system.
The courts granted Catherine's husband sole custody of their two kids. Catherine hasn't been allowed to visit, and her kids told the court they didn't want to see her. She believes her ex-husband influenced this outcome.
I've read enough about parental alienation and these kinds of issues that I understand intellectually that they have to say that to keep my husband or my ex-husband happy. But to think that the children that came through my body could say that is just, there's something physical about it. It's a physical thing that is just unbelievable.
Japan is one of the few countries in the world with a sole custody system. It gained international attention at last year's Tokyo Olympics, when French father of two, Vincent Fichot, went on a hunger strike outside the main stadium.
Mes enfants ont été enlevés à Tokyo le 10 août 2018, et pour lesquels je n'ai plus de nouvelles depuis.
The Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade has provided consular assistance to 82 children involved in parental abduction and child custody cases in Japan since 2004. But it's not just foreigners losing access to their children. When former Japanese Prime Minister Junichiro Koizumi divorced, his pregnant wife got custody of their unborn child, while he got custody of their two sons. By the youngest's 18th birthday, they had reportedly never met their father. Tameo O'Meara is an expert in family law. She's also Catherine's lawyer.
日本は昔は家制度というのがあって、家の
Historically, men were the only decision makers in a family, so parental authority went to them. Japan's family system ended after World War II, giving women the right to claim sole custody. But the idea that only one parent has custody remains.
離婚する夫婦はすごく喧嘩をしていて仲が悪い状態です。そのような仲が悪い2人が子供のために話し合って、あの、1人 要な時に必要なことを決めることができないと考えているのです。このシステムを子どもの福祉にかなうようなシステムに変えていかないといけないと強く思います。
Tomeo is taking the fight to the Japanese government, hoping to help parents like Catherine.
私は今2つの集団訴訟の共同代理人になっています。一つは日本がこの連れ去りを違法とする法律を作っていないこと、それが憲法に反するという訴訟です。でもう一つは、離婚後に、離れて暮らす親と子供がちゃんと会える面会交流のための制度が作られていないこと、これが憲法に反する。
Tomeo and Catherine are hopeful that if successful, the class actions will force the Japanese government to change their laws. But while they wait, Catherine is stuck in a desperate situation. Without visitation rights, the closest she can get to her kids is outside their apartment block.
So Catherine, you've been given the address of where your children live.
Yes,
with your ex-husband.
Right. Yes.
How far away is it from here?
I'm not exactly sure. This is my first time to go and have a look for where it is.
So could it be one of these apartment buildings?
Yeah, probably one of these apartments, that's right. I'm feeling a little bit nervous and a little bit, I'm...
Excited?
Half excited and half a bit worried that maybe I'll get in trouble for trying to approach them.
What would happen if the children came out now? How would you feel? How would you react?
I would feel really happy, but I'm also a little bit nervous at their reaction. If they rejected me or ignored me, I'd feel bad. Last time when I found the apartment they were living in, I found their doona covers hanging on the line, so I knew it was definitely the apartment that they were living in. So then every time when I walked past there, I looked up at that apartment and just sort of thought, oh, they're there. You know, and if the lights were on, oh, they're home. And if the lights weren't on, oh, well, who knows where they are. Just made me feel comforted that they were safe. You know, a lot of Australians say to me, well, why don't you just go and get your kids? Why don't you just go and get them and bring them? And it's just not that simple. I am fearful of the police or the system and getting in trouble. And because I'm not Japanese, I could get thrown out of the country and lose my right to live here. And then I'd be even further away from the children.
How does it feel to be so close and yet so far?
It's crazy. It's really crazy. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense, does it? That you can come almost up to where they live, but you just can't get that last little bit. And it's just so incredibly painful because you feel like your children are sort of part of you. And it's like an arm or a hand has been cut off all of a sudden. Then I see like this, a mother with her daughter walking hand in hand, and that seems so normal and people take it for granted. And I think that why can't I have that anymore, and why didn't I appreciate that? Simple things just like that.
While some parents are fighting to see their children, others are picking up the pieces after years of separation.
I'm Paul Horton. In August 2014, my kids were abducted. They were taken by my Japanese ex-wife to Japan. 8 years on, they're now being returned to me, the oldest two anyway, and next year, hopefully my youngest as well.
Paul's kids were finally returned just over 2 months ago. They're now living in a blended family with Paul's new wife.
Lunch is ready!
Anne has two children from a previous relationship. She and Paul also have a daughter between them. So with two more from Japan, there are now seven people in the house.
Yeah, it's definitely busy. There's always something going on. Now that we have four of them are teenagers, so it's, you know, always trying to get them out of bed and have their breakfast before it's lunchtime.
I'll take this to their rooms now.
Okay. Can I see?
With his kids recently returned to him, Paul had hoped they'd take part in this story.
Brought you something to eat. It's a bit starving by now, yeah?
They've chosen to stay in their rooms and won't join the family for lunch.
They're not comfortable being on camera and talking about the situation that they're in. I think it's mainly because they don't really understand that what's happened to them is wrong. So the whole concept of this is a bit strange to them or unusual, and it's just making them feel a bit uncomfortable.
Paul is still getting used to living with his kids again. But he says how he lost them is frightening.
In 2011, my ex-wife and I, at the time married with three kids living in England, we'd always lived in England, never in Japan, decided to separate and divorce. It was not the easiest of separations, and we did end up in court over child custody, and she was trying to apply to take the children to Japan on a permanent basis. Thankfully, the courts didn't approve that. And then they went away on holiday to the south of England for a couple of weeks. And on the date that I was due to go and pick them up, I got an email from my ex to say that actually they hadn't gone to the south of England, they'd gone to Japan, and that they weren't going to return.
Paul fought for his kids all the way up to Japan's High Court and won. But he says the system still failed him.
The High Court in Japan gave a return order for all three children, but then we found that when they came to enforce that, all my ex had to do was say no. They weren't able to enforce her to return to the UK, so that was a realisation that actually the system is broken. So then rolling on to 2022, I had an email in March from my ex to say that the older two wanted to return to the UK to continue with their studies. And would I be happy for them to come and live with me? Which of course, fantastic. I was really surprised at that. And yes, definitely they could come back. This is my son's room. I mean, he'd bring a few bits and pieces with him, like the posters, we'd pop that up. He's a big Star Wars fan. In here, we put the shelves together for her to put her books on. Since the kids have been back, it's been, I'm not sure what I was expecting exactly. I knew that it wasn't going to be smooth. It was going to be difficult times as well as good times, just as they are with any kids. But we're all getting used to each other. We're having to learn each other's habits and what we like and don't like, and at the same time try and heal some wounds. So it's been tricky. My kids were stolen from me and me as a father from them. And there's nothing that can be done to put it back. It's gone forever.
Paul's ex-wife didn't respond to emailed questions, but a friend replied on her behalf, writing, "There are two sides to every story." Despite international pressure to change, Japan has stuck with its sole custody system. But a recent government survey found that about 50% support both divorced parents being involved in raising children. It comes as Japan's Justice Ministry drafts an interim proposal that could allow divorced parents to share custody. But it may not pass. And for some, sole custody works just fine.
So cute. Soybeans.
In Japan, it's often mothers who are granted sole custody. Women like Yumiko. When her 13-year marriage collapsed a few years ago, her two daughters became her sole responsibility.
Do you make all the decisions about your children's lives on your own?
Yumiko's ex has remarried. He doesn't see the kids much at all, and that, she says, is his choice.
I want to be involved in the family. それをあんまり望んでいないようなので
Once the husband marries somebody else, they don't really want to have anything to do with their other family. Is that correct?
日本はそれが多いかと思います。
So for you girls, how often do you see your dad?
1ヶ月に、2ヶ月に1回会うかないかぐらい。
So would you like to see him more often?
自分から会いに行こうとすることがあんまりないから、そこまで思ってないか。
And what about you? Do you like seeing your dad?
楽しい。
It's fun when you see your dad? Where does he take you?
買い物とか行ったり、遊んだりする。
Would you like to see him more often?
記念の日とか例えば誕生日とかそういう時に会うぐらいでいいかなって思ってる。
If she wanted to, Yumiko could cut her ex completely out of the picture. Instead, she wants him to be more involved. But because of sole custody, there's no way she can make him.
日本の男性は、まあ、一般的に、まあ、外でお仕事をして、女性は、まあ、家でお家のことをする。っていうのが、まあ、日本の一般的な考え方で。なので彼もそういうあの考えにのっとって割とこう家のことはせず仕事にこう集中してっていう感じでした。なので2人を一人で育ててきた感じはします。
At the moment, Japan is looking to change the sole custody laws here. What do you think should change about them?
そうですね。そのケアをとにかく十分にしてほしいというかあの日本の考え方的にこう制度は制度ですからっていう、 こう気持ちをないがしろにすることが多いかなって思うんですね。あのなのでそのどちらになったにせよ誰かが泣くことがないようにしたいしてほしい。
Japan is one of only a few countries with a sole custody system. This means that after divorce, only one parent has legal authority over a child. It's a controversial law that has resulted in some parents being cut off from seeing their kids.
Cheers.
At least 82 Australian Japanese children have been entangled in the system.Kids like Danny's.
I've been fighting in court for over 2 years, and it's been over 4 years since I've last seen my kids physically, and I find that absolutely ridiculous.
Catherine hasn't spoken to her kids in over 3 years, so her lifeline has become other parents stuck in the same situation.
So we made a group chat of Australian parents who have been impacted by this.It's a double-edged sword. Yeah. It's good to know about other cases, yeah. But it's also sad to hear other cases. So we share all of the tips that we can with each other, but still, you just can't have success. It's just impossible. We're all fighting this impossible, invisible enemy.
And fight they do. As well as supporting each other, they take to the streets.
So raising awareness, I think, is the most important thing because the average Japanese person is just unaware about this situation. So we also have orange parades. I've participated in 4 of those and we all wear orange clothing and we walk through the street and they've stood outside the Ministry of Justice, they've stood outside the Lawyers Association and they have people doing speeches saying, come on you lawyers who are helping people abduct their children and get away with it. It's very colourful. We just need to have many different angles. One thing on its own,is not going to be enough. I think it's going to be a combination of international pressure. I think it's going to be a combination of pressure within Japan. I think it's going to be the class actions and mostly an increase in public awareness.
While trying to change Japan from the inside,Catherine is still locked out of her own family.
I've lost my home, the children, my job, everything. Everything's gone. And now I feel obligated to stay in Japan because my children are here. Will I die before I get to talk to them again, or will they die before I get to talk to them again, or will they have children and I won't meet my grandchildren? I mean, there's just so many fears and grief around future things.
With no visitation rights, the only way Catherine can reach her children is through video letters.
This is my first ever video letter that I've made for you.
I have to let you know that I'm here and that I'm trying. It's really important to me that you know that.
I think about you every day, both of you, and I wonder if you're thinking about me as well.
Maybe I should stop talking because I'm getting upset. One day when you're older, and I really want you to know, even if we never ever reconnect with each other, I want you to know that I love you. Always.
Hi, sweetie. It's been 4 years since we've been able to celebrate your birthday together. I really miss you. I think about you a lot. And I wish that we can spend time together again soon. I love you and I'm always waiting for you. Lots of love, Mummy. I feel hopeful that one day I'll be able to show all of the videos to them and that the children will know that I've always been thinking about them and that I never forgot them, I never abandoned them. I have to hold that hope, otherwise my thoughts will not go in a good direction. So I have to hold out the hope that one day we will be reconnected. And I have to hold out that I had 14 years with my daughter and 10 years with my son, and that they're not going to forget that.
If you were to see your children, what would you most want to do with them?
I think I don't let my mind go there because it's too upsetting. But hug them if they'll let me.